is the recipient of state award by the government of Delhi for his meritorious work undertaken in the field of homeopathy, an award of recognition by Robert Bosch Foundation, Germany. He has authored textbook of dermatology for homeopaths and several research papers presented in international and national conferences.
The next speaker of the session is Dr. Jayesh Billare, Institute Chair Professor of Chemical Engineering, IIT Bombay, PhD in Chemical Engineering and Material Science from University of Minnesota, USA, and postdoctoral work at UMass Amherst and MIT, USA. His research work includes 3D scaffolds, hollow fiber membranes, stem cell expansion, and nanomedicines across multiple systems of medicines. And he is especially known for his work in homeopathy. He is also the proud recipient of Life Achievement Award today from our Vice President, Honorable Sri M. Venkaiah Naidu. He's an expert in cryo-electron microscopy of soft nanomaterials and an elected fellow of the National Academy of Science India, the Indian National Academy of Engineering, the Maharashtra Academy of Sciences, and the Electron Microscopy Society of India. He has numerous publications, patents, and awards to his credit, including the PRC Distinguished Visiting Professorship at the University of Minnesota, USA, and the National Academy Reliance Platinum Jubilee Award for Application-Oriented Research.
So let's begin the session. Let's begin the session with our first speaker, Dr. Raj K. Manchanda. The topic of his deliberation is overview of research and new way of potentization. Over to you, sir.
Make sure that there's a session and my discussants and dear friends. We have a journey of about 40 years, and it is not possible to recapitulate that journey in just next 30 minutes. And at the same time, introducing a concept which we have been able to develop after a lot of brainstorming with practitioners, scientists. So if you see this program of these 2 days, the complete program is what we are doing in CCRH and how we can connect to everyone. All these sessions have been planned in such a way that profession should get feel of what is being done, and we should also get honest feedback from the profession, what we should do. So with this opening remarks, I would just like to start with my presentation. Next. Usko dekh lo, koi baat nahi. We'll start from here, but next session ke liye dekh lo. So, dear friend, CCRH was started around 50 years back, first as a combined council with Indian system of medicine, where Ayurveda, Unani, and Homeopathy Council was there, and then on 30th March, Society was registered, and now this is how we are completing 40 years as an autonomous body of earlier Ministry of Health and now Ministry of Ayush. Now, what vision we have been able to develop? If you see the story of homeopathy, when it was discovered, then when it was recognized in India, and the present scenario, we were just thinking what we had been following and what should be our future vision. So we could feel that we have to do work that can impact globally. So our vision is to promote research that contributes towards improving public health care in the country, as well as development and acceptability of homeopathy globally. Homeopathy is practiced in about more than 80 countries in one form or the other. So it's not possible that we can grow in isolation. And further, our focus was that whatever we should do, it should be somewhere translated into the clinical practice of. So our mission is conducting scientific and ethical research, enhancing the success rate of clinical practice. If our research is not contributing in that, that research may not be required. The another requirement is promoting safe, quality assured, and effective treatment in healthcare delivery, and ensuring global acceptance of homeopathy. So with this mission and vision, we are having a multi-dimensional research activities right starting from cultivation of raw material to drug standardization, then drug proving, then verification program, disease-oriented clinical research programs, collaborative projects, epidemic management programs, basic research project, and documentation and publication center. So as any other department of Government of India, we do have all other multidimensional activities. And we are showcasing all these multidimensional activities during these 2 days of conference to you. If you see our infrastructure, barring these red areas, we have presence in all other states, maybe small, maybe big units, we have. So we have around 24 units all over India. To cover these red areas, we have signed so many MOUs today, so that let there be extended activities of CCRH. If you see our outcomes, we have done several hundreds drug standardization of several hundred drugs. Somewhere pharmacognosy activities have been done, because when homeopathy was recognized, all these standards were not available. It is a different matter that even these standards also needs to be constantly improved. In drug proving, we have worked in about 112 drugs. Even for clinical verification, we are doing the clinical verification of those drugs. So what are these drugs? I'm going to discuss separately. We are using different types of study design, right, starting from observational studies, which were earlier long-term observational studies. Then we have started with focused short-term observational studies. We are doing randomized controlled trials, both blinded randomized controlled trials as well as open-label controlled trials. So far, we have undertaken about 168 studies, majority in infective disease, but we have covered almost all spectrum of different clinical spectrum. I think they are repairing that. Dekhe zara. So, aim is to, right from the beginning, with the establishment of this institution, the aim had been to systematically develop and undertake research in homeopathy. We were privileged to have various experts from India and abroad. They were constantly contributing, advising, guiding, criticizing. All these things has contributed in our growth. And even now, and we have, and really we are thankful, we should be thankful to Government of India in that this type of situation, institutional mechanism is not available anywhere in the world. And it will be pity if we have not been able to utilize this successfully. Okay. When this council was started in 1978, one of the challenges was that the existing data that we have in homeopathy, is that sufficient to move forward? Or if we need data, what kind of data we need? Since I was just trying to see why we had chosen so many other drugs which were not very, very conventionally used in homeopathy. Because we took it for granted that all the drugs which are polycrust, which were developed during Hahnemann era and thereafter, are the perfect, and they have a perfect data. We need not to work on that. And we have to work only on those drugs which are fragmentarily proved, where we have less information. So that was the thought process. And another thought process was that the drugs which have Indian origin are likely to have more effect on Indian population. So this was the reason that we initially adopted about 80 to 100, only those drugs which were being used in Ayurveda and Indian system of medicine, and we tried to do homeopathic experimentation with those drugs. Ab ye fir ja raha hai to. So anyhow, with the information what we have in our literature, with meticulous planning, we have been able to develop standard treatment guidelines, which we have released today, in respect of 20 diseases. On one hand, we have a report in different countries. They say that homeopathy is not effective in any disease. So at least we have given at least basic information about these 20 diseases, the level of evidence we have in homeopathy as on present day. What we have basic data that was generated many years ago. Then we have some of the published reports, and then we have consensus meeting with the experts, those who are using homeopathy every day in their practice. On the basis of that, and then we have clubbed the information about the diagnosis, we have clubbed the information about the analysis of each cases based on diagnosis. I must tell you that the observation, like we see 12 observations of Kent, then we see Herring's observations. These observations were created when we were not having proper knowledge of disease diagnosis. And that was required at that point of time. But now when we have disease diagnosis, this is the duty of every homeopath to make first diagnosis and then see what he can treat and to what extent he can treat. क्या हो भाई हाँ यहां पे आगे आगे फिर गायब हो गया अब देखिए एनीवे सो ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ दैट वी हैव आइडेंटिफाइड इनिशियली दीज 20 डिजीजेस बट वी इंटेंड टू इंक्रीज नाउ दिस डॉक्यूमेंट इज गोइंग टू बी अ डायनेमिक डॉक्यूमेंट वी विल बी मॉडिफाइंग दिस डॉक्यूमेंट विद द मोर एक्सपीरियंस विद द मोर रिसर्च In clinical verification, as I discussed with you, we have used only majority of the drugs are of Indian origin. In addition to that, we are working in public health area where we have identified certain pockets in India where screening is being done by homeopathic doctors along with yoga specialists and health workers. We try to identify early cases of hypertension, early cases of diabetes and early cases of non-communicable diseases, try to give them homeopathy along with advice to lifestyle management. And this is how we have been able to work, help at least around 100,000 patients. Then under our Swasthya Rakshan program, this is also to popularize homeopathy and at the same time give health education to the public about homeopathy and how they can be healthy. So these type of activities are some are part of the government and some we have innovatively designed. In addition to that, we work, as I told you, in epidemics as well as in homeopathy for healthy child. You are going to get complete information about each one of this in different sessions in next 2 days. We are having this journal. We have about now, it is being now accessed about 1,44,000 and from several countries. But as a result, now we have international collaborations with several countries. Aim is to move whatever we know, let us share with others, and whatever other better things others have, let us adopt and innovate and improve. In our basic research also, we have undertaken about 37 studies so far. And what we have realized that unless we have our own setup, it is not possible to continuously evolve and innovate. And as a result, we have been able to develop 2 labs of our own, and we are working on 2 other labs, one in IIT Mumbai and another is with BESU, that let us have 2 high-quality, high-impact labs. I sincerely feel that we have to nurture basic researchers, and they have to understand philosophy of homeopathy and then see how much potential this system has. Just to nurture budding researchers, we have this scheme where in the morning you have seen we have given awarded scholarships to many. Now, coming to the main topic, that was that if you see into the potentization situation, that why Hanuman thought of potentization? First, he thought of only dilution. That because he was upset with the drugs of that time which were being used, and he thought, let me reduce the quantity of these drugs. So he started diluting. Like today, if you see, every one of us, or majority of us, or majority of the public after the age of 30 is popping up one or the other pill every day. And we know sometimes they are harmful, but still we have to take to keep things going. That was the similar situation what I feel at that point of time. On one hand, patients were having so many rampant side effects, and this is how he changed the discussion. And first, he started making dilutions, and then by the time, in about 25 years, he could evolve into a method of potentization. Then he said, no, syrup dilution is not good. We have to succus is proper. So if I imagine his thought process, he was, I think, two centuries, his thought process was far ahead of his time. But even at that time, dilemma prevailed, that if we have to succus, how much succussion? And if you see into the nitty-gritty of all these publications of that time, you will find that initially it was a very, very haphazard method. Then he said, no, this is not the way. Let us standardize it. And gradually that standardization of potentization was developed. And now, and it was Russian scientists, they suggested to go for more high potencies, and this is how these high potencies started. Otherwise, Hanuman, if we see his entire practice, it was somewhere not around 24C, 25C, but majority of the practice was below 12C. It is a different matter that by the time we talked of sixth addition of organ, he gave another scale of 50 millisimal scale, because he was constantly innovative. But we have to ask ourselves, are we innovating thereafter? If yes, to what extent? So if you look at the existing method of potentization, which is given, there are three scales, and it is already given in all the pharmacopoeias. We have HPI, we have 7-8 pharmacopoeias. We are homeopathic potentization. They are using one Hanumanian method where only manual succussions are given. Then Kosakovian method is used where machines succussions are given. Normally for high potencies, pharma companies are using Kosakovian method, and for otherwise, they are using handmade potencies. And there are so many questions about the forces, and so many publications are also there on this. But as a practitioner, sometime you must have seen that in your practice, a patient comes, he gets all right. He sometime comes again. You feel that, okay, let me give this medicine. You give that medicine, symptoms are same, but patient is not approved. Why? Doctor thinks that I might have selected rock medicine because it is a well GMP product. But can I test it? May not be, because it is a dilution. It is a high dilution. And this is how we face criticism, even from scientific community, that it is possible still to standardize raw material, but it is not possible still to standardize dilutions. And that too, if we go beyond certain limits. So can something as minor as difference in batch, sometimes you will find you will not getting the same batch. So whether both the batches are same, but there is no way to look into it. And this dilemma I have faced while working as in the Drug Technical Advisory Board meeting, while working with some of the very eminent homeopathic doctors. One eminent homeopathic doctors came to me. He told, sir, today I had a very bad, though my patients are better, but I am feeling very bad feeling. I said, what is your feeling? He told that today I was called by ex-minister. He told me that few hours back, one Baba came and he gave me this water and he said that you will be all right. How your medicines are different than this? He was saying that he never wanted to offend me, but he was very polite, but was very tactful. And I think, sir, everyone is now reading about homeopathy, about entry cases. And then when we see criticism, if you see the ESEC statement, what they say? In European countries, ESEC statement, what is the learning point from that? They say, at least you mention what is there in your drug. We say, we have mentioned Aconite 30. So okay, then what is 30? 30 mugram, milligram, what does it mean? This is what their statement, and if we write that 10 to the power minus 60, what message it will carry for the patient? So these all thoughts were with us in CCRH. We are because this is one of the fundamental research, is one of our dilemma and one of our area, and only for the last 10, 15 years, we have started working. Earlier, we were working only in the field of clinical research. So what are the challenges we face? As of now, our high potency medicines are very, very gullible. We have no way to verify the content of our drugs. Quality control of these dilutions is not feasible owing to undetectable limits. Back potencies stored since many years are being used for the sake of raising high potencies. Batch variation is there, and mid to high dilutions are beyond Avogadro limits. This all we know. We also know that even these high potencies are effective. I know from my own practice that a patient of migraine, I could not help up to the potency of 1 mg. The moment I gave 10 mg, he never had migraine thereafter. And this is one publication which I am just showing you, is a case of Ritter's disease. This man was on deathbed at Nehru Homeopathic Medical College, and we could not help him until we gave 50 mg to CM potency. So when I think that if Avogadro limit is the ultimate thing, then why my patients are improving? Why in India, 70 to 80% of practice is being done without, beyond 30? If you ask even your own researcher, I will tell you my experience. I told all my general duty medical officers in Delhi government that let us all start the treatment with 6 potency. They said, okay. But then after 2 years, I came to know that nobody had picked up those 6 potencies from the store. They all are very happy with 1 mg, 10 mg, and 50 mg. And we know that 1 mg, 10 mg can be more gullible. But they say that clinically these are effective. What is the truth? Another very point, WHO has also stated that for homeopathy, quality assurance is only in doubt because we have to focus only on the process. Another very interesting, my experience, that one of the suppliers to the government dispensaries, he discussed that it is very easy to make homeopathic medicine. I have back potency, I will put few drops and you cannot say anything whether I have succussed and I have not succussed. So what is required is process control. How many? And there is no way to check that process. So what to do? Then came this concept in 2010 when research from IIT Mumbai stated that homeopathy medicines are nothing but nano medicine based on nanotechnology. And now with their recent publication, they have come out that their biological principles are as per the Hormesis. Now, even if we agree to this, that in high potencies, nanoparticles are present, how to detect them? So these were all questions which are there. This is one publication where they stated that original material of the drug is there as nanoparticle. And then they stated that the size of nanoparticle is not changing majorly after 6C potency. Parallelly, even CCRH at IIT Delhi did similar experiment, and this was published in Indian Journal of High Dilution, and they could also detect nanoparticle, and they could also say that these nanoparticles are not only nanoparticles in high dilution, but are silica-coated. Then there is another paper came, why extreme dilutions, each non-zero symptom, a nanoparticle hypothesis based on froth flotation. So what they did, they experimented, which all these things are going to be discussed in greater detail by Professor Bilare. What they did, that in homeopathy, the process is such that majority of the nanoparticles are transferred to the next dilution. That is why even at 200 and 1 m dilutions we have. Then I asked Professor Bulare once that for how long does that froth remains? He said, but not more than half a minute, maybe 1 minute. But if our manufacturer is not using that process that immediately transferring into the next level of dilution, then what is happening? We are losing n number of nanoparticles with each higher dilution. So we have Hanumanian method, we have Korsakovian method. Korsakovian method is also very perfect in that way because the froth goes down, they have demonstrated scientifically. And that only 1% layer remains inside the. So Korsakovian is also, that is why we have high potencies. Then another experiment by Professor Nandi also shown that there is a possible to characterize nanoparticles, that whether this nanoparticle belongs to 6 potency, 12 potency, and 30 potency. And this is where the standardization of homeopathy is coming up now. Now in 2016, another paper by them, IIT Mumbai, stated that establishing the interfacial nanostructure elemental, so they could see even in inorganic salt. When they had shown in aurum, so it was said that, okay, it was a metal, it is possible, not in others. They have shown even in that. In 2017, that was the last paper by them, where they have shown that even the Similia similibus curantur needs to be changed to principle of hormesis. When I discuss this, that in high potencies, homeopathy medicines, there is a possibility of hormesis. My friend from Israel and my friend from many people said, sir, for that level of thinking, that hormesis, even at that potency, needs to be further worked and further, there is a need to further work. Then another thought came to our mind, is it necessary to dilute 200, 1M, 50M and CM? Because by now, we know two things, that due to succussion, what is happening, size of nanoparticle is not moving drastically after 6, 7, 8, and after 8 to 9C, hardly there is any change. What we are doing, we are just reducing the number of particles in every, by raising each potency. So there is a possibility of giving more succussion and moving forward. And this is how this concept of hormesis, if you don't know, it is a very well established concept where biphasic effect of in pharmacology is known as that if you increase physical dose of a drug, it will be toxic, and if you reduce its physical dose, it will become non-toxic, and it will rather, its stage will come when it will start stimulating the response. And this is how homeopathy works. But the question is whether each drug has that kind of hormetic effect or not. So while we were grappling with this, this concept of potentization came to our mind after brainstorming with IIT Mumbai scientists and scientists from Kolkata. And this process says that we need to, preparation of homeopathic medicine by new methodology will be done, and giving higher number of succussion in lower dilution with measurable solute, with Avogadro, within the Avogadro limit. We need not to go. Because if our job of dilution, primary job of dilution was to reduce only safety was the main concern, then all the drugs, even best of the poison, after 3C potency is non-poisonous. It is well known. So why to go beyond that? Which will be testable in terms of measurable quantity. Higher number of succussion would ensure proper formation and encapsulation of nanoparticles of the drug of different degree. And phenomena of hormesis is evident in homeopathic remedies made with low dilutions. This is also well known. And the present method will bring these remedies into the concentration range of hormetic biological actions. So objective of this invention is to rationalize the preparation of potencies, name and specify potencies accurately through an improved nomenclature, standardize the process which would help regulatory compliance and easy and less time consuming process of potentization, and it will be cost effective. When we raise potencies, if we start raising potencies with alcohol, can we imagine how much alcohol is going to be used? And this methodology says that up to 4C, and that is 6 dan potencies, the number of succussion will be up to 100 level, to ensure formation of nanoparticles of equal size, which will remain like that till high potency, highest potency. In subsequent potencies, number of succussion will be in multiplication of 10 for the desired equivalent potency, and new nomenclature will have two components. First part will depict the equivalent potency, and the second part will depict the dilution factor in measurable terms. And this will be the new nomenclature. In chemistry, it is well known that up to Avogadro number, from mu to nano and to from the zepto, all these nomenclatures are already there. And my co-speaker, Professor Bilare, is going to tell you in greater details about this concept. And now, the new nomenclature, what we are proposing to the profession is 1C, 2HEM, 3U, 6DAN, 30HP. Here, the first term is same, what we are using now. And it only shows the number of succussion we have given for the proper silica coating. And the second is actual dilution factor. Now, actual dilution factor makes all these potencies scientific. It is possible to characterize each medicine at all times. It is also possible to measure in times to come quantification of each potency where we can have better clinical effect. Now, if we compare this existing method with the new method, in existing method, if the raw material is not available, use back potencies. In this method, this will not be possible. You need to have raw material, otherwise you cannot make those potencies. 12C and above dilutions are beyond Avogadro limit, whereas all potencies right from 1C to CM remain the within Avogadro limit, thus measurable. Number of nanoparticles reduces considerably due to wide gap of dilution factor from 6 to CM, whereas one-step dilution method ensured that each potency has all required nanoparticles in all potencies, thus make the process efficient, potent, plausible, and replicable. And reduced number of nanoparticles are likely to have less clinical effectiveness in spite of silica encapsulation due to succussion. And if you will be surprised to know that except in Indian and very few doctors, majority of the part of the world, they are using still low potencies. And considerable number of them is less than Avogadro limit. So proper formation and encapsulation of nanoparticles of each drug, that can be measured in times to come, if we have to develop that kind of possibilities. And nomenclature is being questioned always, like with ESAC report, and here there's no question of that nomenclature. One point is telling about the process of potentization, succussion, and the other is telling about the, even the homeopathic doctor, those who are used to giving 1 mcg, 10 mcm, they are also happy to give 1 mcg, 10 mcm, because I often see that they hardly see what they are giving in that concert. They go by their gut feeling, they go by their experience. And they are going to get the same encapsulated, much a drug which will have much more nanoparticles than the already they are using in their practice. So the whole process will be, and further studies will be possible, mechanistic studies will be possible. New developed potencies will have better quality and improved efficacy in terms of their biological effect. New nomenclature will help in regulatory compliance as a result of standardization. Chances of reproducibility of result in scientific studies will increase, thereby adding credibility of experiment and to homeopathic science. Less time consuming and more economical. So all will be happy. Patient will be happy because they will get more effective treatment, quality assured drugs, cheaper drugs. Practitioner will be happy because they will have more reproducible results, quality assured and verifiable if they want to see whether this batch is different from the other. This is possible. And the drugs will be plausible. Pharmaceuticals will be happy. They are the propeller of this, in fact, the propeller of this innovation. Easier and quicker manufacturing will be there, and they need not to make 3,000 drugs all the time. Whatever is the demand and whatever the raw material is available, that has to be made. Otherwise, they have to say this is not available. And quality delivery, hence more reliability of pharma sector will be there. Otherwise, sometimes we get impression that what we are making. And pharma regulator will also have option of regulating these dilutions, which are otherwise not possible. So friends, this is not possible by CCRH alone. This is possible if the pharma companies decide that they should have R&D labs in their pharma companies, and they need to invest on it. Medical colleges have to come up, they have to do a lot of experimentation, maybe sometime re-drug proving, so many clinical studies to verify, re-verify, and see what can be the best way of doing the thing. It is only possible, otherwise it is not possible. So what we are looking at CCRH is that all this machinery has to work with CCRH, only then this kind of process, and we can systematize homeopathy. What is my vision and our vision at CCRH is that homeopathy is a nanomedicine of 21st century. It is for us. Whether we succeed in market this like that, otherwise there are several forces are working to denounce this, dump it, and then reintroduce as a new system of medicine in the form of nanopharmacology. I was talking to some of the nanopharmacologists. They said that present day we have not been able to develop nanomedicine in modern system of medicine also because we don't know about their side effects. So as a result, not many nanomedicines are coming, but they are working towards it. And this is where I feel conventional and homeopathic medicines are going to meet somewhere in times to come. But we need to do a lot of research in this area. And here again, one slide I have picked up from Papi Anandi's presentation because I was thinking and it was already there. So when I was reviewing it, she was also giving the same, that this is what Rabindranath Tagore said years back, that homeopathy is a new science with rational philosophy at its use. But we have forgotten that we thought it is an old science. It is not an old science, it is a new science, and it needs a lot of research. So we require more scientific interest and inquire into matter. Unfortunately, majority of homeopathic doctors have only focused on clinical research, not on basic research. There are few exceptions are there. So thank you very much for getting involved, changing lives, living united. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for giving us an insight about the new way of potentization and an overview about the journey of research activities undertaken by CCRH in the last 40 years. Now we welcome Dr. Jayesh Billare here, and we request him to make his presentation.
Well, respected and dear friends on the dais and in the audience, I use the word friends here because, as you can see here, my affiliation is with the Chemical Engineering Department, and I'm a chemical engineer. And for all of you to give me the warm welcome that you have is really an amazing feeling. I must thank the breadth of vision that CCRH and Dr. Manchanda have had in bestowing a couple of awards upon us today. We are glad to acknowledge that the work that I'm going to be talking about here, which forms the scientific and technical basis of what Dr. Manchanda just described as a possible new way of making and naming medicines. This work has been a collaborative effort of a large group of us, Prashant Chikarmane, Abhirup Basu, Mayur Temgire, Professor Suresh, Dr. Kane have all contributed to this in various ways. So I need to acknowledge the group effort in doing this, and it's an effort that has paid off very richly in terms of our scientific understanding. So we're very happy to be able to talk to you today about what these various bits and pieces of work have been. There's about 5 or 6 papers that we've brought out in this area, and if you've studied all of them, then you don't need to listen to me anymore. So it's going to be a bit of a review of what we've done there. So let me begin by first pointing out to you the importance of nano in medicinal systems. Yeah, this is not specific to homeopathy. It actually turns out to be a slide which I use when I talk about our allopathic research work, because we've been working across systems of medicine. We've worked with modern medicines. We've made a nano formulation of carboplatin, which has been very effective in reaching the retina, which is a protected organ. We have also worked in the area of Ayurvedic medicines, and now, of course, homeopathic medicines. So the points I list here are all important, no matter what the system of medicine is. And certainly, it's important for homeopathic medicines. So the first point is that of macrophage evasion. The possibility of inciting an immune response is small when nanoparticles are present. Secondly, some nanoparticles are able to cross the blood-brain barrier, which makes them very effective for delivery of drugs for brain-related conditions, not only physical ones, but perhaps those that rely on abnormal functioning of the brain as well, which has been a barrier today for most diseases, mental disease. Nanoparticles can also slip through cell junctions. They can bio-integrate to surfaces. They can deliver large aliquots as compared to molecular forms of medicines, and this is where the allopaths are extremely interested, because they have a new vehicle for drug delivery here which can deliver drugs very effectively. And lastly, this phenomena of enhanced permeation and retention, or EPR, which is a well-recognized physiological effect associated with tumors, helps these nano medicines deliver themselves very effectively to tumorous tissues. Yeah. So it turns out that these advantages are seem to be universal. And this was a slide I actually already had before we started our work in the area of homeopathic medicines. Yeah. So there's nothing new here, but it turns out that homeopathic medicines fall exactly in this, or take advantage of everything I have listed here on this slide. So what I propose to do is to cover some of the fundamental aspects, the physico-chemical aspects, and some of you who have heard me before might find that it's the same, and yes, it is the same. And I'll also then go on to looking at some of the biological action that we've seen lately through hormesis. But we steer clear from any medicinal effects, yeah, because we are not competent to do that, yeah, right? So the clinical angle is your field, and we leave it to some fundamental biologic effects, with the hope that it'll inspire some of you to carry this on. Yeah. So, all right. So I'm going to answer three questions in this talk. Yeah. What is there in a medicine? How did it get there? And how does it act? And the last point, how does it act, is not at a human clinical level, but how does it act on a biologic system, a cellular system, a cell line system, which is where I end, yeah, right? Which is my expanded field of expertise ends, such as it is, ends the area. So that's where we leave it at. Yeah. All right, so in terms of understanding what the material is, right, there's a mystery that there's nothing in a sample of medicine, but that's not true. There very much is, and that was Prashant's first paper in this area. So there's something that is there, and it actually provides an activation of some cellular response. Yeah. So we are now firm believers in a material basis of the action of medicine, yeah, which is something not everybody likes. Yeah. There are those who prefer a mystic aura around their system of medicine. Yeah. And the presence of an energy field that goes from one vial to a neighboring vial is something that we simply do not accept. Yeah. We are firm believers in a material basis, and you will see that thread throughout my talk today. So if you happen to be of a contrary school, I'm afraid I'm going to rankle your feathers quite a bit. Some elementary stuff here, but just for sake of completeness, I should mention it. So whenever a medicine is made, it begins either as a liquid or a solid. It goes through a titration process, often with lactose, and then a series of successive dilutions. You all know that. But the process has to be done in a particular way, and Dr. Manchanda has already shown the slide, so let me speed through some of these, which are, of course, well known to you. Was a total mystery to me until I actually visited a plant and saw this in action. So the process, whether it involves a Hahnemannian process or whether it involves a Korsakovian process, all use a special machine. That machine could be a human who lifts a bottle up and bangs it on a table or vibrates it. Or there are umpteen machines of this sort which are available in the literature. And there are many theories to show that in this so-called super Avogadro state, there are something strange is going on, and they all now appear to us as pseudoscience. Yeah. And there are several theories of this sort. Even the water memory theory we no longer wish to adopt. I think there is a proper basis of the medicine. You don't have to bother about epitaxial theory or clathrate theory. We basically believe that there is a nanoparticle retention, and the nanoparticle retention along with an encapsulation is the material basis of this medicine. I am hampered by not having a pointer here. That's because the laser pointer doesn't work here, and I do not have a way of controlling the mouse from here. So you'll have to guess where I am on the slide. So some of these theories are of course well known. There's a whole bunch of them, and there are proponents of some or all of them even today. We of course by now have become skeptics in these theories, and we simply believe a material basis. So the first bits of our work was to actually understand what is there in a bottle of medicine, no matter what the potency is. And we just did this with electron microscopy, which is a standard tool of nanotechnology, has been there for, what, almost a century now, and, well, a little less than that. And we start seeing photographs like this, and these are some of Prashant's first photographs. So we have, all the work I'm going to be talking about is published. This is Prashant's paper. There was a guest editorial associated with it. We were also lucky to have one, and I mean lucky, to have one publication in the American Chemical Society, which I think made them, probably gave them enough grief that they have never accepted another one from us subsequently. Then we also looked at inorganic salt-based. Our initial work was with metals, then we looked at inorganic materials, and then we looked at some of the machines that go into potentizing. We believe that's an important part of the process study. And lately we are looking at hormesis. We have a published paper here in this area. So what we have really shown is that nanoparticles remain despite super Avogadro dilution. So this is the key. This is a key finding, a key difference from what people used to believe. And we also explain the process by which this happens. So I'm proud as a chemical engineer to have studied the process of manufacture and been able to explain that using standard theory of Roth flotation, which I'll quickly go through in the time we have. So the kind of medicines we first began with were metallic medicines, and we chose those that were unlikely to crop up as dust or contaminants in a typical lab, because we knew our referees would be hard on us when we start finding material in something that is super Avogadro diluted. So we did that, and then we also looked at some of the inorganic based medicines. We also did some work with herbal and nosodes, but we were unsuccessful there. So let me also tell you where we have failed, and so far we have failed to look to find nanoparticles in nosodes and in herbal medicines. The reason is obvious if you look at the tool which we are using. We are using an electron microscope which requires contrast. The contrast comes nicely from heavy metals, whether it is a metal or whether that metal is present as a salt, and it provides excellent contrast we are able to see. With herbal systems or with cellular-based systems or nosodes, there is no contrast, or the contrast is extremely poor, so poor that we can't detect it. But we are still trying, and we are struggling, and we hope we or someone else does find these in future. So the work that we've done so far is restricted to metals and to inorganic materials. Electron microscopes are nice expensive cameras. That's all they are. They give you nice high magnification views. They give you three types of views. They give you what I call in the top left as a passport photograph. It gives you a direct photograph of the object. On the top right is a dark field pattern. I think of it as the typical X-ray, planar X-ray that I get when I break a bone and the X-ray technician puts me behind, so it's literally like that. And the bottom one is the electron diffraction pattern, which is a characteristic fingerprint pattern, which I think of literally as the fingerprint, which is encoded in my Aadhaar card. And once I have that information, I can go back to the Aadhaar database and pick up which element or which material is present. So the bottom picture here, which all three of them are given by electron microscopes, the bottom picture gives you a unique fingerprint. It's literally a fingerprint of the material by which you can identify it very uniquely. And this gives us the precision and the confidence to tell you that if I start off with gold in making a medicine, it's only gold that's present, because we look for other things and we don't find it because there is a fingerprint match. So this is the Aadhaar database which we probe into. It's the electron diffraction patterns here. And using this, here you can see zincum at 30C, and you can see zincum at 200C, and so on and so forth. So all these, this data told us that the majority of the crystal size, the nanocrystal, the crystals were in a nano size, 5 to 10 micron was the modal value, and there was a size distribution, of course, yeah. And we can measure them quantitatively by using appropriate tools today. Atomic emission spectroscopy and mass spec gives you excellent way of measuring the concentration. And here is one such result, which shows you on the y-axis the concentration of the starting material in the final product, and on the x-axis is the potency. And you can see that there is a drop in the concentration up to about 6C or so, where the dashed vertical line is there. And beyond that, there is no drop in concentration, but there is a scatter of data. Each of these data points is one data point of either one bottle of sample, which came from a couple of manufacturers, came from multiple batches. Some came from multiple batches of same manufacturer. Some came from different manufacturers. So the scatter in this diagram, especially towards the right, is a batch-to-batch scatter of the concentration of a typical sample bottle. And this highlights the problem Professor Manchanda mentioned a few minutes ago with respect to trying to have a quality control assurance on this. The scatter is so wide. Remember that the y-axis is a log axis. So a little bit of scatter here translates to a large scatter in the actual concentration. But also you can see that the concentrations are at a very measurable picograms per ml level, which modern medicinal chemists will say, hey, that's too low to do anything. But we'll see. We'll answer that question in a few minutes. And how does this happen? Well, this happens to a process which we have studied. It involves froth flotation. The process of manufacture is important, therefore the machines are important. The kind of whether you do succussion with a impact or a bang, or whether you do it by shaking, or whether you do it by vibration, there is always an energy associated with the system. The energy is shown here in this slide as creating bubbles. Yeah. And these bubbles happen due to a phenomena which is well known. It's called hydrodynamic cavitation. Hydrodynamic cavitation results in bubbles. Some of these are small, tiny bubbles. And then these bubbles rise to the surface, carry with them small nanos. They don't have enough buoyancy to carry the larger particles. And this process results in a refinement of the sample. The refinement is with respect to particle size and weight. Then the small ones come up to the surface. The larger ones are left behind. And this is something that actually happens only up to, the actual refinement happens only up to about 6C. Beyond that, every nanoparticle is carried from step to step, batch to batch, from each potency to the next potency. So this phenomena allows us to explain the results that we've had and give an explanation as to why it is that despite superavogadro dilution, you do have the starting material in your sample, in your final sample. And the explanation again is very simple. It's the fact that you have froth flotation. There are nanoparticles which are transmitted in their entirety from batch to batch, and hence this process of succussion is important. The process of putting in energy into the system is important. There are other aspects which lactose titration gives, which I won't talk about today. Safe to say that lactose does play an important role in metallic and inorganic medicines. If you did not believe me about the bubbles, here is a high-speed video evidence which shows that the bubbles are formed. This is a set of photographs of the bottom part, which shows that the last slide, which is slide, the last tile, which is tile L, shows that there are, most of the bubbles have disappeared. That's because this is the bottom of the container. If you look at the top of the container, you will see that there are these bubbles which are still present at the surface. These bubbles last for a few seconds to a few minutes, and then they dissipate. So as long as these bubbles are there, they hold the nanoparticles at the surface. The moment these bubbles break away, nanoparticles redisperse, and it forms a uniform dispersion in the sample. So this was good evidence for us to be able to convince the American Chemical Society to have it published in their Langmuir journal, and something that gives a process understanding of how these medicines are made. if you measure concentrations, you can see that the concentrations are different in the bulk at the surface, and you can measure these as a function of potency, and we've been able to do that to about 15 C or so. After that, it goes beyond the detectability of the instruments that we have. Yeah, we are proposing that we start looking at even better instruments to be able to do this, but here we are all pushing against limits of what the analytical chemists have been able to achieve so far. We have also shown that inorganic medicines behave similarly, and here, in fact, we were able to show that they are there are issues here. The first issue was that most salts, inorganic salts, are water soluble, so how can they form nanoparticles? Well, it turns out very simply that most inorganic salts are not soluble in alcohol-water mixtures, and they do form nanoparticles because they hit a solubility limit. And secondly, there are instrumental issues. There's radiation damage, and you got to run the instrument correctly, and it takes time, and you can't have the instrument owner breathing down your neck saying, get off the instrument, the next guy is waiting to use the instrument. So there are issues here. There are stability issues also in the microscope. But be that as it may, we showed similar things which I won't dwell upon, that even inorganic materials retain their original starting materials despite being super Avogadro diluted. Again, using the same tools, we used the passport photo, we used the X-ray image, and we used the Aadhaar card to get a definitive ID on the samples that we had. So let me just skip ahead. These are all multiple data for different samples. We also went back and redid our metal work, and we found that yes, these particles are present. There is a silica coat on most of these particles. We try to understand how this silica coat comes about, and we have a theory now which is yet to be proven, but which indicates that there is sodium silicate leached from the walls of the container, and this leaching is assisted by the high turbulence that the process of succussion imparts to it. And when it contacts ethanol solution, it polymerizes into some silicate chains, which then coat the sample. Yeah. So here is a schematic image of trying to show how this coating takes place. And your sodium chloride crystals, which are straightforwardly soluble, now get encapsulated in silica, and this provides a degree of controlled release to the system. So these are results that we showed. We also are currently investigating some more advanced studies, and these are by using a technique called X-ray photo electron spectroscopy, XPS. I won't go into the details, but it's a technique which allows us to not only measure the elements, but also the kind of bonding states that the sample has here. So with respect to the bonding states, we are able to show some results here. Again, these are fancy, expensive equipment, and this is something that we have to wait weeks to get access to. But when we do, we get some interesting results like this to show that the mechanism we had proposed for silica coating is actually happens. And we find that initially the silicon is present in some other way, and then as succussion builds up, the form of silicon changes, the kind of polymerization changes. So the process of succussion seems to be important. The energy input into the system is important. Yeah. Lastly, I'm going to be talking about this process of hormesis. Hormesis is a biological response process. It's a basic phenomenon also called a biphasic response. And here we have a recently published paper, again led by Prashant, and there's an accompanying guest editorial which the famed hormesis expert Edward Calabresi has also written, saying that this is a key concept. The concept is very simple. The concept is that at a low dose, at a relatively low dose, there could be a stimulating effect, which at a high dose is one which provides an adverse effect, which is exactly what your system of medicine says. So this is something that Calabresi has been talking about with respect to other medicines, not with respect to homeopathic medicine. So what we essentially did we did some studies with respect to some cell lines and looked at the effect of homeopathic medicines on these cell lines as a function of potency and as a dose dependency function. And the test we use has this fancy name called MTT. It essentially looks at the cellular activity, the mitochondrial activity. And it's a rather simple test of measuring the color developed. And you can back calculate what it is. So on the a typical result is one like this. On the y-axis is this MTT, which shows how active the cells are, right, how stimulated the cells are. And on the y-axis is the on the x-axis is the concentration. And you can see that this concentration again is in the order of a few to picograms per ml. In fact, it's a fractional picograms per ml. But remember here, we are not talking about a large organism. We are talking about a few microscopic cells. So the dose variation from a cellular response to an organism response to a human response is something that we still need to figure out. But these are the doses where we see this effect in at a cellular level. And what it shows, the horizontal line at 100% is the control, and the dotted lines with the colorful symbols which go above it indicates that in a certain band of concentration, there is a stimulatory effect that this particular medicine has on this cell line, which happens to be a HepG2 cell line, which is a liver cell line. So this indicates that there is a stimulatory effect under certain concentrations, in a certain concentration regime. And this is shown for a few other medicines as well. This is Stanamet, but not for everything. Not all medicines do show this. Yeah. There are some which do not show this stimulatory effect. Here you can see most of the stimulatory effect, if anything, is statistically weak, where the dashed lines go above the 100% line. Yeah. But be that as it may, what this indicates to us is that there is something going on at these low concentrations, right? And something biologic going on which seems to stimulate the cells. If you look at the total number of cells, there's no change. The total number of cells is the same. If you look at some other parameters, such as cell cycle analysis, which you can do with a fluorescence-activated cell sorter and suitable biological probes, again, there's not much difference. So there's not much difference in number of cells. There is not much difference in the way the cells are behaving, except that there is a stimulation that MTT shows. So it means that these cells are actually getting stimulated, which is what hormesis is. So it activates certain pathways in the cell, which seem to give it an extra burst of activity. And that activity could well be an activity that has a medicinal basis. But that's something that we have not been able to show, nor are we competent to show. Translating this to a larger system, such as an organism, still has to be done. So, to summarize, the hormesis effect seems to be a stimulatory effect, and it's important to note that it happens in a certain concentration band, and this concentration band is where we should target a potential concentration associated with a medicinal product. What this band is, we cannot directly translate from here into clinical practice, but hopefully we will as we gain more correlations between cell line studies and human studies. This now leads us to what, just a few more slides which lead us to what Professor Manchanda has already explained in great detail. By virtue of the super Avogadro dilution phenomena, there is doubt in many minds. Yeah. And although our work has shown that despite super Avogadro dilution, there is a material present, is something that that not all of you are willing to accept. I know there are many skeptics amongst you who may not even accept this, which is fine with us. Someday you'll turn around, but we'll wait for that. So what do we do until then? Right? So this is what I call as a stopgap measure. The stopgap measure is to use number of succussions as an important tool into the process. Right now, the number of succussions is tied to dilution. Typically, in a manufacturing process, 10 succussions per step of potency change and so on. Another problem is that the tools used by us are extremely expensive, hard to use, and even if you are an expert at it, you've got to struggle to do it. Yeah, right? You need to have a clone of Prashant many times over to be able to do this on a routine basis. So with all these things, it's not possible to really specify this as a QA-QC method. So what do you do? So that's where the new method comes in. Here we ensure that dilutions are not super Avogadro. We de-link dilution and suppression. And the basic process is the same, but the dilutions are restricted to Super Avogadro, but additional suppressions are given. And the naming system is more scientific in the sense that we use modern SI nomenclature to indicate the concentrations, and we use the number of dilutions, the dilution effects, and the number of suppression effects together to give a combined name of this sort. And then we have tables like this. You saw a small summary of this in Professor Manchanda's talk. So let me now actually wind up by summarizing what I said. So to repeat, we are firm believers in a material basis of the medicine. The material basis involves encapsulation and therefore perhaps controlled release. We have shown this only for two types of medicines, but our hypothesis is that it acts across all the types of medicines, including nosodes, herbals, and so on. And the biological basis is hormesis, and these nanomedicines are present across all three common systems of medicine in India, and we think that they form an important class of products which will influence not only modern science, which it has already so far, but also homeopathic science in the way I have described to you today. With that, let me stop here and thank all my funders. Thank you very much. I don't know if there's format for questions, but I'm open to questions. If not now, later. Thank you. There are certainly things that change when you go from a bulk material to a nanomaterial. Some things are simple to understand. Surface area, for example, right? Surface area induces activity, which is easy to understand. However, what
changes are not taking place, even if there is change. The
No, it's not just the size. Size is something we've been able to measure.
Because it is understood that when the change in size takes place, the characteristic changes. So you have shown here that even if you have gone for higher dilution by trituration or by succussion, the size has not changed.
Yeah, so not only the size, even the concentration has not changed. So what changes? To answer your question in short, I don't know. We haven't done enough studies to prove what happens when you have extra succussions put. However, we have a hypothesis, and that hypothesis requires us to you to do some exquisite material science of materials. The hypothesis is as follows. Whenever energy is put into a system, which it is with succussion, and some of our latest work shows that it's unpublished work, but it shows that the turbulence created by succussion, by impact, is enough to put in energy into the system, which causes these nanoparticles to even reach their melting points. But be that as it may. So with the input of energy into nanoparticles, there are surface defects and internal defects that can be created, surface roughness which can be created, which we have not shown. This is hypothesis. But there is possibility of these effects happening, which need further study. And I hope somebody will do that. We have done the easy stuff.
Okay. I mean, in connection with this, one of the come out of that problem of the biomedical kind of things and homeopathy and all that, suppose you use, I mean, this is an my personal thing, that suppose recombinant interferon or interleukin 2 or something like that, you potentized, you can start with microgram and then go to the abrogate level, and then see what is the result which is supposed to happen at that time and that time. I mean, that is the way to answer that question.
Absolutely, yes. That's the way to go ahead. And not so much with recombinant, but there are cellular systems that Dr. Shah is working on already, where he's trying to rejuvenate some of these old nosode type systems. And there is a good chance. In fact, your idea is even better. If you start off with the DNA, or part of a DNA strand, or a recombinant, or a protein, any biologic system. But I prefer DNA because DNA is easily detectable using PCR. Right? You can magnify small amounts as well. So here is a hint for those of you who are interested in pursuing this work. Prepare a nanomedicine using a DNA and then find its trace in a 1M product with PCR. That's it.
Good afternoon, sir. I have a question here. Thank you for the enlightening presentation. Sir, I have a question regarding the different solvent, whether the succussion, 10 succussion or 100 succussion, whatever, that differ with the solvents like water, alcohol, ethanol, methanol. So whether that varied in your studies?
Yeah, it turns out that alcohol-water mixture, 90% or so, or at least alcohol-water mixtures need not be always 90%. Alcohol-water mixtures appear to be a key. Right? It's important. Why? We realized that when we started looking at inorganic medicines such as salts will never form nanoparticles unless they are in alcohol water system. The alcohol water system provides a limited solubility and therefore forms nanoparticles of the inorganic material during the process of dissolution, number one. Number two, the alcohol is necessary because it forms that polymerization reaction associated with the silica coming off the walls of the glass. And this, of course, means that you do need to do all of this in a proper glass, and it's specified in the pharmacopoeia what sort of glass and so on.
Yes. So, and if it is only water and we are not using the alcohol in it, though Hanuman suggested that few drops of alcohol, so whether that make any difference? Did you have any?
Yes, I think it's going to make a big difference. Certainly for some systems which have high water solubility but limited alcohol solubility, it's certainly going to make a difference for those. For others, I can't say.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, sir. Actually, some students have completed PhD work on nanoparticles under my guidance. I find that in an animal experiment with nanoparticle, there are always some complication. But this homeopathic medicine, there is no complication. So how homeopathic medicine and that be equal to the nanoparticles? And that is the number one. And the number two is that with SPTLC examination of the medicine, homeopathic medicine, with increasing potency, there is a thick band of silicon. So that is present in all the medicines. So if in all the medicines the silicon increases, how the action is very different?
As succussion proceeds, I'm answering your second question first. So as succussion proceeds, the silica that comes off the walls coats it more. Yeah. That's our hypothesis. Still, systematic studies need to be done, right, to show that there is a steady increase. But that is our hypothesis, that as you succuss more at a given dilution, more silica comes off. Whether it all forms coating on the particle or whether some of it forms independent silica particles of its own, we don't know. But these are possible.
There is present in all the medicines.
Yeah, our hypothesis is present in all the medicines. Now, we were able to show only two because that's all we can look at in electron microscope. We were able to show this for metals and we were able to show this for inorganic particles which are visible in electron microscope. Unfortunately, the nosodes are not. Unfortunately, herbals are not because they are very poor contrast here. But we are still struggling. Some of our students are still struggling. So let's wish them luck here. I think we are running out of time, but...
After two brilliant talks by Dr. Manchanda and Professor Bellare, each time you are asking some questions, it's like, you know, it's a process of succussion. And Professor Bellare, he made a very nice comment on while speaking. That is, you can all rest assured that the active ingredients are very much present in ultra-high dilution. And he said that, I know that there are many skeptics amongst you. I can assure you, Professor Bellare, that there is no skeptic here, at least in this audience. And everybody...
Thank you.
You know, yeah, and everybody would, agree with you. And both the talks were so nice, and it generated so many questions, and that really shows how beautiful it was. Professor, in fact, Dr. Manchanda, when he said, he was very cautious right from the beginning, and he said that, okay, let's not talk about ultra-high dilution, let's not go beyond Avogadro, and let's be confined within Avogadro only, and then such kinds of experiments can easily be done in almost many places. You know, whatever Professor Bellare has spoken about, He made a very extensive study. You know, all his results are authenticated by TEM images. He has used FTIR and all kinds of, you know, spectroscopic results he has produced. So that's a quite an elaborate thing. But naturally, across the country, you cannot do all such, and you do not have the access to many such equipments. But what I find is what Dr. Manchanda was mentioning, that you can be up to this. That means don't go beyond Avogadro. And what Professor Bellare also mentioned, then can you think about, you know, standardization of the process of succussion, and then by changing that each time we can have lots of experiments and you can generate lots of data that how the different characteristics change with, you know, the different kinds of taking care of the different types of succussions, the number of succussions and all that. So it was so nice. A lot of questions must be there. For example, there had been questions on by several of the researchers here about the concentration of nanoparticles in bulk or in surface, and how do they change, and how that concentration change itself will be effective in the clinical. Because every time we talk about one of the results of Professor Bellare, it has to be clinically validated. That okay, when you do this, then clinical validation is a major point. Universal silica confining is one of the very good, you know, points that he had mentioned, and I'm sure that lots of questions arise in your mind that how really you many of you will be wanting to know more about it. I have got, you know, out here, three other great scientists out here. Dr. Ghosh, who is the former director ICMR, National Institute of Immunohematology. So he would like to speak, and I'm sure that he has got...
Thank you, Professor Roy. You have already said most of it, that at least Dr. Professor Bellare's study shows that the material is there. One of the problem with allopathic medical people who are arguing that material is not there in your homeopathic medicine, how it is working. So at least that part is sorted out in this study. But then there are two, three questions coming. As Dr. Das has said, that if all of them are containing silica, then why the procedure is different? See, problem is that you are putting that medicine in the mouth. Now, how this silica coating of different strength is being processed by the complex system in the digestive tract and in the mouth, we do not know. That needs to be sorted out. The second part is that what will be the biological activity of this? Another thing which has been said, that look, I have used nanoparticles, they are invariably toxic. As you said, that material when you are used in a nanostate is a toxic. But in homeopathic medicine are not toxic. That actually can be explained, because one nanoparticle which you use in allopathic medicine, their dose is much higher. They are actually at the level of toxic dose. But here you are not using that. And maximum thing which both Dr. Bellare has repeatedly said is that he has not seen it, how it works in a clinical situation. He has seen how it works in cell and how it works in a simple system on which it can work. In a complex cellular system which is also diseased, how this medicine work after it passing through the gastrointestinal tract or being in the mouth, because one of the theory in homeopathy is that as you spread more area in the mouth, your activity of this medicine increases. That's why water potencies were supposed to be better. So these are some of the things which it is not sorted out. What today's lecture does not sort out everything which is being questioned in homeopathy. But one most important thing it sorts out, that medicine is there. Medicine is there. That is sorted out.
Dr. Ghosh, and then Dr. Anil Khurana, who is Deputy Director in the CRA.
Sir, two, three observations when I was talking this whole point with Dr. Jayesh Pillare earlier. One study we had taken with St. Stephen College in Delhi, and students of that college, we discussed one project on Allium Sepa with Dr. Jayesh Pillare on the same pattern. And in those, we have a common findings of that. And this is also puzzling for us, even for Dr. Pillare also, that at 200 potency, the amount of nanoparticles is increasing. You know, that is very surprising. With the dilution factor, the nanoparticles are increasing. That is one common finding with both of us. Another study where we say that these medicines, though having a hormetic kind of a effect, though they have a stimulatory kind of a action, but even if they are undetectable, the diluent medium is behaving like an original particle, actually. Earlier it might be, there was a theory of memory, water memory, which was proposed once upon a time. And Luc Montagnier also published that kind of a study with a DNA of, and then he also gave a similar kind of understanding that you can generate DNA even without having that kind of a structure, nucleotides available there. So these were some of the findings which are puzzling with us. But for this new method of potentiation, we gave a pilot kind of a study on antifungal activity in Noida. Dr. Manchanda did not highlight that in his presentation with a simple reason that we need to replicate that kind of study again and again to come to a conclusion that new process of potentiation is equally biologically effective as compared to the existing one. But with this pilot study which we have done with antifungal study, with this new method of potentiation, in one of the potencies, it has more antifungal activity as compared to the existing potency, and in another experiment, it has equal effect. The new potency doesn't have a lesser effect, that is for sure, but we need to replicate these kind of models, and we will be doing more such kind of studies to authenticate and validate the proposition which we have not taken up. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rao. We just listened to very excellent presentations, one by Dr. Pillare and one by Dr. Manchanda. And both raises two new points, and a lot of discussion is already we have heard, and that is in the main as well. Number one, nanotechnology we are using or explaining in the nanomedicine term of homeopathy. That is only the size of the particle. He has this is the first demonstration in the dilution, ultra dilution form. There is a material present. But many people have to accept this and demonstrate this is true. That is one thing. The second thing important, how these nanoparticles are available bioavailability in the body and giving the response to a diseased person. And that is very, very important. Till we don't know, only demonstrating the presence of this material or substance in a very, very minute form is very difficult. Otherwise, the same question will always there. If you cannot detect any medicine, how these ultra-diluted or high potencies are working? That is remain. But it's a good start. With modern tool and technique, at least we can demonstrate something new which was unanswerable till date. Second, Dr. Manchanda very well presented last 40 years contribution of CCRH, as well as he introduced a new methodology for potentization. As we all know that this potentization is a unique process for preparing medicines in homeopathy, and that is the backbone. And everyone is using, all manufacturers are using a different potentizing machines or different methodology. And that's why it's very difficult to get the results of the similar kind of different preparations. So this is very, very appreciable. Dr. Manchanda, he is introducing a new methodology that everyone should accept, and it should be uniformly implemented to all manufacturers. Then only we can say that the potentiation process is similar, and whatever we are getting 1 mg or 10 mg medicine that is equal by all manufacturers producing these drugs. So these are the two very, very important messages what we got from this excellent presentation. That is my opinion that we should concentrate and get that one. Thank you very much.
So finally, let's give a big hand to Dr. Manchanda and Professor Bellare for two excellent, truly brilliant speeches. Okay. Thank you very much.
So here we come to the end of this session. There's a small announcement to make. The delegates who are proceeding to hall number 4 for the panel discussion on global issues in homeopathy, they may proceed to the combined hall number 2 and 3. Now I would request Dr. V.K. Gupta, Chairman, Scientific Advisory Committee, CCRA, to come on stage. I would request Dr. V.K. Gupta to felicitate Professor Ajay Kumar Roy.
A big round of applause, please.
Sir is requested to felicitate Dr. Kanjaksha Ghosh as well. Now I would request Dr. Ajay Kumar Roy. To felicitate Dr. Rakesh Shukla. I would request Dr. Ajay Kumar Roy to felicitate Dr. Anil Khurana. I would request Dr. Kanjaksha Ghosh to felicitate Dr. Raj K. Manchanda. I would request Dr. Kanjaksha Ghosh to felicitate Dr. Jayesh Bellare. Thank you, sirs. Thank you, sirs.
Thank you all. Thank you, the chairpersons, the discussants, and our speakers. Thank you.
Good afternoon. This is Dr. Harleen Kaur. And we are going to begin with our session on applied clinical research. We are already running out of time. And just a small repeat of announcement. People who want to attend the session, the panel discussion on global issues on homeopathy, role of professional associations, may kindly proceed to combined hall 2 and 3 instead of hall 4. The session is going to happen in hall 2 and 3. We would start with our session on applied clinical research. May I please request the chairpersons of the session, Dr. Niranjan Mohanty and Dr. J.D. Daryani, to kindly grace the dais. Dr. Niranjan Mohanty and Dr. J.D. Daryani. Dr. Niranjan Mohanty is former principal, Dr. A.C. Homeopathic Medical College. And Dr. J.D. Daryani is the chairman, special committee for drug proving, CCRH. I also request Dr. Jaya Gupta, scientist 4, CCRH, to please grace the dais. She will be the discussant in this session. I also request the speakers of the session, Dr. Menachem Oberbaum, Director, Center of Integrated Complementary Medicine, to kindly grace the dais. Dr. V.K. Gupta, he is the Chairman, Scientific Advisory Committee of CCRH. And Dr. L.K. Nanda. He is former principal, Dr. A.C. Homeopathic Medical College, Bhubaneswar.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Niranjan Mohanty is a recipient of several awards, like Homeopath of Millennium Award and Great Master Award in 2001. He's also an awardee of Homeo Ratna. He'll be chairing the session along with Dr. J.D. Daryani, who is Chairman Special Committee of Drug Proving CCRH. He's also former Principal cum Medical Superintendent of Dr. M.P.K. Homeopathic Medical College, Jaipur. We have with us Dr. Jaya Gupta as a discussant. She's coordinating clinical research, clinical verification, Arogya Health Melas and Seminars, and CMEs for the Council. She's also been awarded WHO Fellowship on Control Strategies for Infectious and Non-Communicable Diseases. Dr. Oberbaum, who is one of our speakers of the session, is Director of Center of Integrated Complementary Medicine of Jerusalem, Israel. He's also former Vice President and a founding member of GIRI, International Research Group on High Dilutions Research. Dr. V.K. Gupta, our second speaker of the day, is a Padma Shri awardee. He's Chairman of Scientific Advisory Committee of Council, and he's also former honorary physician to the President of India and Principal Nehru Homeopathic Medical College. Dr. L.K. Nanda, former Principal AC Homeopathic Medical College, Bhubaneswar, has an experience of over 40 years of homeopathic practice, both in government and private. He's also a recipient of Dr. D.K. Bose Memorial National Best Teacher Award. Coming on to the first talk, the talk is on analytical view about India as global leader of homeopathy, Carpe Diem, seize the day. I request Dr. Menachem Oberbaum to kindly come over the podium and start with his talk. Thank you.
First of all, I want to give my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Manchanda for the honor to invite me to give this lecture. In a preliminary communication with him, we outlined the subject of my lecture very generally, urging me to decide on the details myself. Why not share your experience in India, he said. Speak about what you have observed in India. Well, I felt I had two possibilities. The first one, to focus on the things that impressed me, which is a safe approach, while another approach is to urge what should be changed or developed further. This is a more problematic approach, as everybody enjoys hearing positive impressions, and nobody, inclusive myself, of course, likes to be criticized. Well, I decided to choose the more problematic approach. As you know, guests tend to tell how great the soup was and how beautiful and comfortable the furniture are. They tend not to say that sitting on the sofa caused them a backache and they tend not to say that sitting on the sofa causes them a backache and they suffered of a gastritis on the next day. Therefore, one might be in doubt, was the guest really satisfied or not? So I solved the dilemma. As I said, I decided to choose the dangerous way to say that the sofa was not really comfortable and the soup could be improved on. The reason for this decision was that I think that with some slight changes in the attitude, India has the full potential to be not one of the leading countries in homeopathic research and practice, but the leading country in the world. It is undisputed fact that India is an homeopathic giant. Over 300,000 homeopathic physicians are practicing in India, and nearly 10,000 new ones are added to this number every year. There are 195 undergraduate colleges for homeopathy in India and 43 for postgraduate education. 8,117 government dispensaries and 235 of governmental hospitals are providing homeopathic treatment in India. India leads in terms of numbers of people using homeopathy with 100 million people depending solely on homeopathy for their medical care. The use of homeopathy is steadily growing in India and exhibits an annual growth rate of 26.3% in the past year, the highest among other Ayush modalities. Most of these numbers exceed the numbers which are published summarizing the corresponding numbers in the rest of the world. If the Indian data are so impressive, how comes that so few Indian publications are published in peer-reviewed journals? Why are only very few Indian homeopaths sitting in international committees? How come that India didn't turn to be the Eldorado of the homeopathic medicine, where all the homeopaths are making their pilgrimage to? There are probably many reasons, but I would like to argue that the main reason is the condition of homeopathic research done in India. Putting in PubMed two keywords, homeopathy and India, restricting the results to clinical trials, we get 17 hits. The same combination using instead of India, Germany will reveal 41 hits. Of course, an Indian researcher might calm him or herself by examining British homeopathic research, which would retrieve only 11 hits, France 13 hits, Holland only 6 hits, Israel 6, and the United States 19. This is a more impressive presentation. But what about those findings in proportion to the population of these countries, which resembles actually the use of homeopathy? The results do not look so good for India. India just seems to disappear. Although the total numbers of publications of Indian clinical research published in all the homeopathic journals exceeds most probably the numbers of publications of all these countries mentioned together, how come that only 17 clinical trials were published in peer-reviewed journals? As you might have guessed, it is, of course, related directly to the quality of the studies. Let me present two examples, an American and an Indian study, as comparison. Both retrieved at random. The American, a diabetes trial, had been published in a very good journal in the JAMA. If you will look at the affiliation of the 8 authors, you will see that only 2 of them are working in clinical departments in which most probably diabetes mellitus is treated, the 2 first ones. The other 3 are from a statistical and epidemiological and a health policy department. I assume that the physicians of the 2 clinical departments have some statistical and epidemiological knowledge sufficient to make the statistical calculation of this trial. Nevertheless, the research project involved 3 other departments which brought into the study the specific effect needed to turn a mediocre paper into an excellent paper. In other words, a good clinical trial, one should not only involve clinicians, but preferably also specialists from professions like statistics, public health, and epidemiology. I took an Indian paper which I retrieved at random from an Indian journal. The details of this paper are not important. You might understand the reason that I don't plot the paper. Let me just say that this paper had evaluated a homeopathic remedy in low potency for a certain pathological condition. The title proclaimed that this is a retrospective trial. Forget about the low scientific value of a prospective trial, but this trial evaluated results observed in less than a dozen patients. I would even say less than 10 patients, no comparison group. Based on these results, on the results achieved on less than a dozen patients, the author's conclusion was crystal clear. This particular homeopathic remedy was effective for the indication tested. A clinical study, which had in the best case to be called case series, conducted by only one clinician, stated that the results are proven unanimously. There was not even a note of doubt, nor the important sentence under these circumstances as further studies are needed. Since we speak about a conclusion, let me please show you an example of an impressive conclusion. For that purpose, let us have a look at the conclusion of the American study which I quoted, which you see plotted now. When you read it, you must imagine the courage, intellectual integrity, and stamina which was needed to sit and write a paper on a failed study which was followed for a whole year, which is a long time, by researchers who were probably convinced to be able to observe a positive difference in the group treated the way they believed in, and finally understood that their work was in vain and what they had so firmly believed in was nothing but an illusion. To sit and to write, to have the stamina to sit and to write a paper. The courage to report negative results is regretfully not seen very often in Indian studies. Of course, not all the Indian publications are of such quality, but many of them do look somehow similar. Randomized trials involve a huge investment of time, money, and people. Therefore, they warrant expert management and need to be managed from their inception, almost like a business enterprise. To review the literature, develop a protocol, apply for funding, and design data collection forms require lengthy consultations and a meticulous planned approach. According to the literature, in the conventional setup, it is estimated that 85% of research is wasted. 85% of conventional research is wasted. Factors contributing to research waste include conducting studies that address questions of low importance to patients and clinicians, those which are designed without reference to a systematic review of the evidence, those that fail to take adequate steps to reduce bias, and those that fail to report their result entirely or inadequately. How comes that in Indian clinical studies, almost no waste exists, and almost all the studies confirm the hypothesis on which they were based? Admittedly, there exists no perfect study. All research studies are limited by practical and ethical considerations, and it is impossible to control all sources of error, even in fully randomized and meticulously blinded trials. Multiple studies are thus usually required to convincingly confirm or disprove an hypothesis. Multiple studies, not one study. Nevertheless, I'm scrutinizing Indian publications in Indian journals for years, and it seems that five major sources of methodological problems could be observed repeatedly. I'm afraid that I'm running out of time, so I'll skip this part. I'll just present the five. I'll not go into it because it will last too long. So what should and can be done? At first, the understanding that performing research, clinical and basic, is a profession and can't be carried out as a hobby or in addition to other activities. It requires the harnessing of all the intellectual, mental energies available for this purpose. Only experienced personnel should be used. To run a clinical trial, a lot of experience is necessary. Running clinical and basic trials is a complex task with many pitfalls on the way and more often than not, disappointments at the end. Therefore, not to forget to mention the most essential trait for a person to conduct good research, intellectual integrity, courage, and stamina to report results of failed study, often proving the hypothesis on which the study was based as false. Another thing important to understand is that in order to run a good clinical trial, being a good practitioner is certainly not enough. Paradoxically, it seems that being a good practitioner is rather a disadvantage. A good practitioner is used to involve in his actions and decision also his or her so-called gut feelings, which will most certainly distort the results of a clinical trial. It has to be self-evident that good clinical research cannot be conducted by one person alone. Only a team is able to run such a complex task. Not a team consisting of a director and several subordinates, but rather a group of experts from several complementary disciplines. One cannot run a decent research trial without advice from a statistician, an expert who knows to design a proper study protocol, an experienced person who monitors the study, etc., etc. Finally, one should not forget the importance of good infrastructure, which will help to recruit patients and take special care of those little big and small and big things which are essential to commence and complete a clinical trial. After sharing my opinion what clinical trials in homeopathy should be and how they should be performed, according to my opinion, of course, let me say some words about the publishing philosophy in India. An internet search which I did revealed 25 Indian journals publishing homeopathic papers. This number exceeds the total number of all the CAM journals in the world. I wonder if this large number of journals is justified. Inevitably leads to a reduction of high-quality papers published in those journals. Instead of having one or two journals containing many good publications, we are facing now many journals containing only few good publications in each. The editor-in-chief must produce a complete journal at a fixed day. So what should he do if he still has few pages empty and no good clinical trial? Of course, publish whatever he has. On the other hand, there is no way to reduce the number of published papers. Scientific publishing should not be censored, and everyone is at liberty to publish. The situation will change if only one journal will pick up the challenge and develop excellence by establishing a strong peer review team, even taking into account lack of submitted papers in the beginning. Perhaps follow the example of the Israeli journal, Rambam Maimonides Medical Journal, a conventional general medical journal. This journal was created 6 years ago. Today it has more than 17,000 subscribers from 146 nations and territories. In 2017, they published 39 scientific medical papers out of 61 submitted manuscripts. It is a nice, these are nice numbers. About a third of the journals of the scientific papers submitted that they were rejected. They are now indexed by the PubMed and Thomson Reuters Emerging Source Citation Index, to name just a few. Next year, the journal is scheduled to receive a homeopathy ACE, an official impact factor from the Thomson Reuters. What is the secret of this particular journal? As a new journal, most of the papers submitted were naturally reviews. However, the most important aspect for a promotion and advancement of medicine is publication of original research. To promote such an effort, the editors of Rambam Maimonides Medical Journal established in 2016, besides of a strong reviewer team, the Maimonides Best Published Original Research Prize. This annual prize of $1,000 is to be awarded to the first author of the best original research paper published in the journal over the previous year. This journal has no subscription fees, no submission fees, and no publication fees. Equally noteworthy is that although published by the Rambam Health Care Campus, which is one of the biggest hospitals in Israel and the biggest at the north of Israel, the journal is unaffiliated with any organization or society. A decision was also made when the journal was established to seek no advertising, perhaps the most unusual feature of this publication. Within a short time, the journal reached the impressive numbers which I presented. Admittedly, the Central Council for Research in Homeopathy in India, under its current management, has profoundly changed the homeopathic scientific scene in India. Big efforts are made to create international connections. Research, basic and clinical, is actively promoted. Excellent and enthusiastic people are hired. Huge sums of money are invested. In addition, India has some advantages which no other country in the world has. Unimaginable high number of patients, unimaginable high number of enthusiastic and brilliant homeopathic physicians and researchers, and a general atmosphere of not hostile to homeopathy, also by the government. This is no doubt an extremely promising start. However, this momentum has to be translated into efforts to share this fantastic progress with the world outside of India. This can be done only by improving research and reporting. These are the keys to progress and acceptance by the conventional medical system. Therefore, as the leading Roman lyric poet Quintus Horatius Flaccus, known as in the English-speaking world as Horace, said more than 2,000 years ago, carpe diem, seize the day. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Obobon. We are actually running behind time by 1 hour. So I really request the speakers to please try to cut short their presentations. I know it's difficult that the topics they're presenting on are very important, but just considering the time constraint, if you can just try to cut short your presentations a little. The next speaker of the day is Dr. V.K. Gupta, Chairman, Scientific Advisory Committee, CCRH. He'll be presenting on an overview of standard treatment guidelines. Dr. V.K. Gupta.
Respected chairpersons, Dr. Narendra Mohanty, Dr. J.D. Daryani, Jaya Gupta, learned speaker Dr. Oberbaum, Dr. L.K. Nanda, fellow colleagues and delegates. The Central Council for Research in Homeopathy has made an attempt to develop standard treatment guidelines without compromising the principles of homeopathy. This presentation outlines the overview of standard treatment guidelines in general and homeopathy in particular. Why standard treatment guidelines are required in homeopathy and how it can bridge the gap between science and healing art of homeopathy. How homeopathy profession at the level of students, teachers, clinicians can utilize this document for linking research with education. The contents of this presentation are, what are standard treatment guidelines? Why standard treatment guidelines are required in homeopathy? Who should refer to standard treatment guidelines? And structuring of standard treatment guidelines. World Health Organization defined standard treatment guidelines as systematically developed statement designed to assist practitioners and patients in making decisions about appropriate health care for specific clinical circumstances. The use of STG is a time-honored system that works well and improves patient outcomes. World Health Organization felt the need of a document such as standard treatment guidelines, which can list the preferred pharmaceutical and non-pharmaceutical treatment for common health problems experienced by people in a specific health system. This could be a solution to the therapeutic anarchy. Following World Health Organization, Ministry of Health, Family Welfare, Government of India also developed standard treatment guidelines for the Indian context. In parallel, respective AYUSH system under Ministry of AYUSH adopted and developed standard treatment guidelines for their own systems. When implemented effectively, a STG offers advantages to patients in terms of consistency and treatment efficacy. To providers, it gives an expert consensus, quality of care standard, and basic monitoring. To supply managers, it makes demand more predictable and allows pre-packaging. For health policy makers, it provides a focus for therapeutic integration of a special program and promotes efficient use of funds. However, effective implementation is the greatest challenge in introducing standard treatment guidelines. In India, standard treatment guidelines are developed at the national and state level by a wide range of agencies. The adaptation framework uses 10 steps approach with an aim to develop guidelines relevant to India using recommendation from existing guidelines wherever possible. Now let us see why actually we need standard treatment guidelines in homeopathy. According to World Health Organization, homeopathy is the second most popular system of medicine in the world and is being practiced in over 80 countries. At present, approximately 550 million patients are within the ambit of homeopathic treatment worldwide. There are around 3 lakhs registered homeopathy doctors in India. Now, our country has 7,856 government dispensaries, 207 government hospitals, and many private clinics providing homeopathic treatment to millions of people on a daily basis with variable success. Further, when the morbidity profiles of homeopathic clinics and allopathic clinics are compared at primary health care units in Delhi administration or Delhi government, it can be seen from the bar diagram that the flow of the patient with different disease conditions, such as respiratory ailments, gastrointestinal diseases, and other diseases, are common and are equally distributed. A recent survey conducted by Indian Marketing Research Bureau on the acceptance of homeopathy in India across 8 metropolitan cities revealed that 59% people have shifted from allopathy to homeopathy due to its long-term benefits. If we talk about homeopathy practice, 85% of the total homeopathy physicians are in private practice. And many of them have treated several difficult cases with excellent cure rates. They adopt different prescribing techniques, and only few are oriented towards research. Prognosis, diagnosis and prognosis are not recorded systematically. Also, poor record keeping and documentation results in insufficient clinical data, hence less publication. This thereby brings criticism to science of homeopathy from conventional scientists, pharmaceutical, some government and non-government organizations, journals and media persons. So what is the need of the hour? We need to do capacity building, building confidence of physicians at scientific platform, data generation and contribution to evidence, carrying the experiences to successors. This is a cyclic process, and need of the hour is to sustain homeopathy in the scientific world. Criticism in homeopathy can be addressed rationally by generating high quality evidence through clinical research. A large number of patients are opting for homeopathy treatment in India, so every Indian homeopathic physician with good documentation can contribute to defend criticism. On the other hand, fundamental research solves the question towards plausibility of homeopathy. Evidence in favor of homeopathy can be generated at two levels, that is, clinical practice at the individual level and research at institutional level in colleges and universities. In clinical practice, the physician should keep in mind the spirit of aphorism 3 plus, not only aphorism 3, aphorism 3 plus current evaluation and prognosis through standard assessment scales. This will transform a homeopath from clinician to clinical researcher, thereby contributing in generating good quality data. Adding from the previous slide of the various knowledge, capacity building needs to be done among students, teachers, and researchers. This can be done through the document of standard treatment guidelines developed by Central Council for Research in Homeopathy. Central Council for Research in Homeopathy is an apex body conducting research for the last 40 years. It has undertaken clinical studies on various disease conditions, with different study design, durations, and clinical outcomes. Maximum studies are done on infectious diseases, followed by respiratory diseases and lifestyle disorders. The scientists of Central Council for Research in Homeopathy combined the outcome of some of these studies with global research findings. They then structured and planned the contents of the standard treatment guidelines in homeopathy. Thereafter, they reviewed the literature, gathered opinions, suggestions, comments from various expert groups. Finally, CCRH identified 20 important clinical conditions in the first phase. These standard treatment guidelines in homeopathy will be updated from time to time based on current available practices and information. The 20 clinical conditions covered in the first phase are arranged alphabetically, inclusive of both acute and chronic conditions. This document can be used as a tool, ready reckoner, desktop guide for capacity building, generating evidence, and quick reference. The salient features of this standard treatment guidelines are a brief description of the clinical condition, assessment scales to evaluate the case at baseline and follow-up, description of general and homeopathic management of the case, homeopathy therapeutic compendium, which includes research finding and experience of experts. Reliable indications of few homeopathy medicines are described in two parts. They are general indications and characteristic particulars, emphasizing holistic approach. It also includes rarely used medicines with characteristic indications under each condition for quick reference, and the red flag symptoms for referral when there is worsening or complication in the case. Each clinical condition is having various components like definition of the disease, incidence, epidemiology, pathophysiology, clinical presentation and investigations, differential diagnosis, evaluation and assessment, prevention, general management, homeopathic management, therapeutic indications, red flag symptoms for referral in cases of worsening or complication. The algorithm of therapeutic process, that is the flowchart. The contents of these components are written after thorough literature review and authentic sources and are mentioned in the footnotes. Now I shall quickly cover one clinical condition of acute otitis media. This is an important public health problem where prescriptions of antibiotics are high. A randomized controlled trial conducted by CCRH, comparing individualized homeopathy and symptomatic conventional treatment with the objective to compare the effectiveness between the two groups, was undertaken. In addition to this, the number of patients requiring antibiotic treatment was also studied. The results demonstrated equal improvement in both the groups. The requirement of antibiotic was 97.5% in the conventional group, whereas it was none in the homeopathy group. This is a graphical depiction of the improvement in both the groups over 21 days. Thus, both the groups are showing equal effectiveness in curing acute otitis media. This is the flow diagram of treatment process covering different aspects of treatment plan for a patient visiting physician. It shows diagnosis, treatment, referral for standard care in a very concise manner. Several scientists of Central Council for Research in Homeopathy will make presentations on standard treatment guidelines for a specific clinical condition tomorrow in a separate session. It is expected that homeopathy profession related to research, practice, education, pharmaceutical will be greatly benefited from these standard treatment guidelines in homeopathy. Today is the birth anniversary of Dr. Hahnemann, the founder of homeopathy, who made his life worthy. On this auspicious day, I appeal to every homeopathy physician to infuse science into the healing art of homeopathy and thereby igniting the researchers within. Now, we want the delegates, participants, students, stakeholders to go through this document and give their constructive feedback, so the subsequent standard treatment guidelines in homeopathy becomes more comprehensive. Now, the present document of standard treatment guidelines 2018 is available at CCRS counter for display and for reference. This is the book, the hard work done by CCRH. CCRH is also announcing a series of webinars on the standard treatment guidelines. It will be a web-based. Students and teachers can sit in their comfortable places and interact with the scientist expert to enhance their knowledge. The detail mentioned in the CCRH website, www.ccrhindia.nicin. Long live homeopathy. Jai Hind. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gupta, for wrapping up your presentation in a shorter time than was granted to you. The next speaker is Dr. L.K. Nanda, former principal, Dr. AC Homeopathic Medical College, Bhubaneswar. He will be talking on Herring Revisited, systematization of homeopathic materia medica in consistency with modern parameters through clinical verification program of CCRH. Dr. L.K. Nanda, please.
Good evening, respected chairpersons, my co-speakers, land delegates, doctors in the auditorium. I have given the task to deliberate upon clinical application of lesser known drugs. As you know, what is lesser known drugs? Is there any term in homeopathy lesser known drugs? Are the symptoms of these drugs dependable? If yes, how much they are valid? We are using a lot of drugs from Boric Mathematica. 2 lines, 3 lines, 5 lines, 4 lines. We are prescribing on those symptoms, but very often we found disaster result, no improvement. Why? This is lesser known drugs. Maturanka Pura contains 67 drugs. Herring guiding symptom contains 410 drugs. Allen's Encyclopedia contains 1716 drugs. These are the source books of Mathematica. And in these books, the symptoms entered are properly proved, are reproved. And in Herring's Mathematica, symptoms after proving, reproving, confirmed, and then entered. So, Herring's Mathematica is a mature Mathematica dependable mathematica because of these three factors, proving, reproving, confirmed. Present mathematica book available to us by B. Jain or any publisher, they contain 1414 drugs. Complete repository contains 1725 drugs. Synthesis contains more than 2000 drugs. Can we depend on these drugs for the symptoms coded in that? May not. It is we can follow when the drug entered Boric Mathematica is properly proved. May not when the source of symptom in the drug is not written. We do not know it is proved, reproved, confirmed. If we prescribe on the symptom, will be failed. We may not. So what to do? Lesser known drugs are like tip of iceberg. If you see an ice in the water, you will see some portions are above the water, some portions are below the water. Above the water, in the lesser known drugs, the ice portion above the water is seen to us very few symptoms. These are never lesser known drugs. You cannot tell Sabal Sulote is a lesser known drug. You cannot say Justicia is a lesser known drug. We are just seeing some portion, some symptoms Justicia. But a lot of symptoms are immersed below the water level. So now our duty is to see the symptom above the water level in iceberg. This is to be confirmed and validated. And the symptoms below the water level, these symptoms should be reproved and clinically verified before being taken by us. We know Mathematica Pura, we know Hanuman's sincerity in proving, we know Bonnevision's sincerity in making literature, we know Herring's sincerity in preparing his book. They have taken a lot of pain to do these things. But all these stalwarts of homeopathy, even though so careful while entering the drug, entering the symptom, still stress that these symptoms, their symptoms should be reproved and confirmed before being told that it's a valid symptom. See, so much stalwarts they're telling that the symptoms should be confirmed on the patient before telling the valid symptom. Herring has made his symptom 5 grades. First, second, third, fourth, fifth. Fifth grade is a hand mark. Herring knows that the symptom entered in hand mark is correct. But still, sometimes he is doubtful. He left to us that anybody can confirm the symptom and entered my hand mark to make it more confirmatory. So keeping in view these points, keeping in view the concept of the stalwarts like Hanuman, Bonnevision, Kent, Herring, drugs needs now to be confirmed in bedside to tell, yes, the definite symptom of this drug and can cure. That is validity of symptom. So rightly, Central Council Research in Homeopathy taken up this very difficult task for clinical verification of drugs. Very difficult task to do this. Already council proved, reproved many of these rare drugs, lesser known drugs already, after proving also taken up for clinical verification in a very systematic manner, following some protocols in different multicentric program where it cannot be undependable. Already 106 drugs clinically verified, today, and 3 volumes already published, 4th volume today released. All these books contains the symptoms after being clinically verified. Protocols of the council also includes to observe and record clinical symptoms if emerged. You know what is clinical symptom, I need not say. So while proving any symptom was not there in the medicine but emerged, should be taken as clinical symptom and should be recorded in that drug. Gradation of symptoms also of those clinically verification drugs has been made on definite parameters. Now it is time to establish the validity of a symptom based on modern epidemiological and statistical parameters, utilizing the data obtaining during clinical verification. We are in the era of Kent. But now, to tell this symptom is valid, we have to take up the help of the modern statistical and epidemiological parameters, utilizing those data for making it a valid symptom. In this aspect, the modern epidemiological idea of likelihood ratio has a great potential. This is the latest concept, likelihood ratio. So to make the symptom valid, to tell that symptom is rational, the 12 symptoms is very correct, the modern concept of likelihood ratio has a great potential to deal with this concept. Likelihood ratio positive can be used as a mathematical representation of section 143 prognum. Again, I'm repeating, likelihood ratio positive can be used as a mathematical representation of section 143 prognum. Section 143 prognum deals with peculiar, characteristic, rare symptoms. So, in the modern parameters, if those symptoms after being calculated in likelihood ratio is positive, we can tell that this is the mathematical representation of section 153. This offers the possibility of giving more accurate and quantitative description of a symptom based on empirical data. We have got empirical data, and this likelihood ratio LR offers the possibility of giving a more accurate and quantitative description of a symptom based on empirical data. The symptoms with higher LR positive is confirmatory symptom of a medicine, and a symptom with lower LR negative can be excluded. LR positive means the symptom has enough validity, can be taken up as a confirmatory symptom. LR negative means it has less value and can be excluded. This may be a solution to make gradation of symptom. This may be a solution to assess the validity and quantitative value of a symptom of a rare medicine for clinical application. I repeat again, if you take up this concept of likelihood ratio, this will be the befitting procedure to make a symptom valid one. So just now, because time is short, just now I will tell some drugs symptoms available to the doctors in different centers of the CCRH. They applied the medicine of those symptoms and how much cured. So this is a very direct mathematical approach of the CCRH, 100% given this medicine on this symptom, 90 cured. This is a very fantastic data. And the symptoms in Boric, which we may not believe, has been taken off by council, Boric and different Matramanika. Particularly, they have taken Indian drugs and the rare drugs and their symptom for clinical verification, which in many doctors are in doubt. It is a rare medicine, it will act. Many persons asked many times, sir, you are depending on this jacaranda for knee pain, it is a rare medicine. Jacaranda is a very rare medicine for knee pain. But I often observe jacaranda is prescribed in totality, cures say osteoarthritis of knee. So this is a very beautiful task, beautiful work done by CCRH by putting the symptom, observing how much cured, and giving to us in the clinical verification book, so that one can, after going through the book, can know the weightage of symptom, how much patients received, how much cured, and can depend or can discard the symptom of Boric or the other books. So let us see some drugs, Indian drugs, rare drugs, prescribed for diabetes mellitus, and many senior practitioners, they told that prescribing CGM is not homeopathy like this. So let us see. For diabetes, common symptoms are polydipsia, polyuria, polyphagia. Symptoms, besides this polyuria, polyphagia, polydipsia, common symptom, other symptoms in the book are uncommon to us, we can utilize. So let us see what are the symptoms. Cephalandra indica. This is a drug we often prescribe empirically. CGGM, Cephalandra, Gymnema, Uranium Nitricum, we very often use empirically for diabetes mellitus. And either give as an add-on medicine to the allopathic or to consistent medicine or separately. Or many young doctors also prescribe CGMQ 20 drops 3 times for diabetes. Sometimes works, sometimes will not work. When it will work? If the symptoms are similar. When it will not work? When the symptoms are not there, you prescribe as specifics. So in Cephalandra indica, you see, in our verification program, burning sensation all over the body, 91 patients manifested symptom, and after giving Cephalandra along with polyuria, polyphagia, polydipsia, and burning all over the body, 73 cured. This verification record. So see how much a beautiful data we are getting, that depending on the burning all over the body in diabetes patient, 73 cured. So this is a very dependable symptom of Cephalandra, on which one can prescribe, depend, and not as specific. Other symptoms of council, burning sensation in the hand and feet, 42 cure out of 60. If that book you refer, clinical verification book, you will get this result. So in Cephalandra, three symptoms, I remember I practiced utilizing this book. One is burning all over the body, burning sensation in the hand and feet, along with this accompanying symptom, flatulence with distension of abdomen, 62% reported, 47 cured. So these are the symptoms of Cephalandra, verified by council, and I have utilized practice and see on these symptoms there is a good response to medicine. So Cephalandra indica, when I get a case of diabetic neuropathy, complaining of common symptoms of diabetes along with burning neuropathy, I think of Keppalendra. Uranium nitricum is a drug, very rare drug, but has tremendous action. If I'll think of these symptoms verified with them, hypertension, edema, and albumin in urine. These are the symptoms of nephropathy, diabetic nephropathy. So when diabetic nephropathy accompanied with bloated abdomen like lycopodium, ill-tempered and mental depression, all these things are verified. Uranium nitricum acts much better in a diabetes case. Gymnema sylvestre is also an Indian drug, not thoroughly proved. In Bullock Mathematica, only polydipsia, polyuria, polyphagia, and one two symptom, nothing is there. So this is a contribution of CCRS to the homeopathic world. See, it is a good drug for diabetes with the pruritus bulba. There are eruptions reported 152, 93 cured. Itching of bulba 104 reported, 61 cured. Swelling of bulb after itching 152 reported, 93 cured. So see, similarly also a good drug for balanitis. Eruption, itching eruptions of so likewise, time is much less, I'm going fast. Abdroma, a drug, it, you know, polyuria, polyphagia, polydipsia, all symptoms are not here. Here polyuria is there, polydipsia is there, but in abdroma patient, there is loss of appetite. This is a peculiarity. This is proved. While in abdroma, 639 patients reported for loss of appetite, 410 cured. So this is a peculiar symptom of abdroma. In diabetes, there is loss of appetite. Appetite increased in abdroma, 6% reported, 3 cured. So from this, you see, abdroma's peculiar symptom is loss of appetite. Along with this, constipation and vertigo. Cesium, always giving as empirical one. But cesium acts when diabetes accompanied with skin symptom. Like recurrent boils, 128 patients reported, 78 cured. Urticaria with itching, 45 reported, 37 cured. Psoriasis with diabetes, 22 reported, 11 cured. So see, these are the very important, valuable data of council in a multi-centric program which can be utilized by the practitioners. Similarly, lot of I have calculated a lot of groups like just have a look, urinary system group of drugs. Osimum we give for Osimum canum, it is a good drug for right side ureteric stone, good result. 3 patients reported, 3 cured. I'm going fast. Borivia diffusa is a very dependable drug for CKD. I have got this idea from a allopathic medicine, NephroCap. Allopathic doctors are using NephroCap for chronic CKD, and after going through contents, I have seen there is Borivia diffusa, Dinospora cordifolia, and Desmodium. So I got an interest to go through what is the symptom of Borivia diffusa. And in our verification, we have seen scanty urine, 47 reported, 36 cured. Dropsy, 438 reported, 287 cured. Hypertension, 365 reported, 209 cured. These are all symptoms of chronic kidney disease, CKD. So I have seen that after prescribing Borivia on these common symptoms, creatinine level, there is a good creatinine level decrease with a good effect, good result. Dinospora cordifolia is a very useful drug for UTI, chronic chronic UTI. Any chronic UTI reported to me with this symptom, pulsating urine, recurrent fever, burning while urinating, these are all symptoms of verified CCRH, and this is a good medicine for chronic UTI when the repeated UTI is occurring. Ferampic is a drug for, better drug for BHP than Savol-Sulta-Q. Because Ferampic, you see, 64 reported for frequency of urination, 48 cured. Dribbling, 35 reported, 24 cured. So see, all these common symptoms of BPH in Ferampic, good patients came and cured. These are all dependable symptoms, verified symptom of CCRS. And I have seen that Ferampic gives better results than Savol-Sulta-Q in BHP. Similarly, coming to arthritis group, jacaranda, osteoarthritis of right knee, 44 patients reported, 24 cured. A dependable drug for OA right knee. These symptoms are concurrent to main symptom, but time is short. I'm just passing over. Argemon mexicana, I have used in my practice, but happy to see that in the verification, 11 persons reported for left knee pain, 11 cured. So this you can see is a good drug for left knee. Aranian diadema, we often use for calcaneum spur, pain in heel. But often, in my practice, I've seen there's a failure. Because you see, in the verification, 3 patients only reported for os calcaneum pain, 1 cured. But rather, dull aching pain in knee in Aranya, 14 patients reported, 10 cured. So Aranya is, we are prescribing for this os calcaneum spur or pain, is often not very often helpful. So likewise, manga for indica, these are all OA knees verified by council with a very good result, no time. Similarly, Carica papaya, Cynodon, Holaren adnicentrica, all symptoms are verified and very peculiarly we got very fantastic results with this. On these symptoms, after going through the patient reported and cured, we can prescribe confidently and cure cases. Eagle folia, like noxpermicia, diarrhea, alternates constipation. Flatulency, afternoon. Iris tenaxy prescribed for appendix, but not always act, unless there is constipation, bilious vomiting, nausea. Embelia is a good drug, like Sina. All symptoms, itching anus, itching nose, and grinding teeth, canine hung, all symptoms are there, but also with a difference. Kukluma langa is a drug from Haldi. Okay. 15 minutes I have taken that. Okay. So however, time is short, others are there. So I want to conclude in this way. Rare medicines are never rare medicines because symptoms are not studied properly. Some persons use the drug on their study, clinical symptoms emerged, they reported in the book. But these are dependable drugs. If they will be studied like this, the symptoms emerged below the water surface, like iceberg, will definitely come off, proved, reproved, confirmed. So my request to all of these audiences, there are now 4 books of clinical verification. In that, details are there, how many patients reported, how many cured, guiding symptoms in a very 5-6 points, discussion and comparison. So it is an asset to the practitioners. Please go through the book and see how much they're helping to you. Thank you.
always nice to hear Dr. Nanda's clinical experience of clinically verified drugs by CCRH, and I wish we could hear him more about his experience of these drugs. But time is very short, and I would request the chairpersons to please quickly wrap up the session so that we can begin with the next session.
Thank you. I request as why India has not yet recognized El Dorado of homeopathy. Sir, we appreciate your sentiments and keen interest to see India as to be El Dorado of homeopathy. Whatever you have suggested, we have already taken sincere steps to that way. Taking a step further in this way, last year, World Homeopathic Days, 10th April 17, CCRH organized international convention on the theme enhancing the quality of research in homeopathy. And today again, we are here with the theme innovate, involve, and progress. This itself indicates that how much we are serious and working hard for uplifting of homeopathy. We are again thankful to you for your analytical views and request to keep continuing your suggestions in future also for making India as El Dorado of homeopathy. Thank you, Dr.
Thank you, Dr. Zarini. India has made important stride in natural flora. It is understood from the discussion of the three veterans speakers. Important stride in natural flora. We have to make our footprints in the international arena. This is our concern. So it is understood now there is a complex competitive academic turbulence all over the world. And people are looking for its success through professionalistic international approach, ethics, norms, values, and all these things. So we have to take care of it. Any amount of physical infrastructure cannot bring quantum change. It is quality human infrastructure which can bring quantum difference. Therefore, where our council is in the way what we have understood from till morning till date. The talk made by our Padmasri Dr. V.K. Gupta is one line that how we are standardizing our treatment guidelines is one of the indications. The Professor Nanda has told how the verification is going in the right directions to verify the symptoms. So our council is almost all the time busy in standardizing the things in the now. Publication of paper is a very important thereafter. If we prepare our manpower in the right directions, we can surpass anybody in the world to produce paper, to write papers, everything. Our students, which have come out, we have got promulgated a postgraduate course within last two decades. We have prepared our students how to write protocols of research. We are quite aware of the fact that foundation, fundamentals of research are the sample size, sampling method, control, blinding, and statistical tool, all these parameters and the criteria, inclusion criteria, exclusion criteria, so on and so forth. We have taught our students very perfectly. We are confident that within a few years, our students will flood with our papers in the global platforms. Nothing in there. Second, we can also, Dr. Professor Nanda has told, nothing can be known except sign and symptom. If the patient who is ill not is part an organ, symptoms are unfailing guide for the selection of a remedy. It is not the common symptom. The uncommon symptom denotes the similimum. He has emphasized in his speech. He has emphasized how this validations and verification can be made through likelihood ratio. Is a likelihood ratio is a Bayesian theory of 1863. The theory says that populations or the prevalence of symptoms in the remedy prevalence population divided by rest of the populations, which is based on the theory of chance is equal to odd plus or one divided by one plus odd, and odd is equal to divided chance divided by one minus chance.
This is the theory. And we have to understand when the symptoms are bearing the marks. If it is within 1 to 3, we give 1 grade. If more than 3 to 6, we give 3 grades. If more than 6, we give 3rd grade. This is how the likelihood ratio has given establishment giving gradations to drugs. The drugs first evolved, did not have symptoms. Honeyman's Materia Medica, published in the 1820 and 24, did not have gradations. Subsequently, the one in Gusen, the father of homeopathy, a father of giving gradations, 1846 publication came out with gradations. His gradation cannot surpass the likelihood ratio work. And again, this 1879, the gradation has come. So we are in the right direction. I appreciate all these speakers, and they have excellently expressed their views in the present platforms. But little better expression is necessary. But we are preparing ourselves. Our friends should not be disheartened in future also.
Right.
We assure you will do best.
Clinical verification. I want to inform that CCRH has included Naranjo criteria in its CV protocol, and we are establishing the causal relationship or of each symptom, and so we are calculating the LR for each symptom. And in our new protocol, we have added MIMOP and Auradel scales to establish further more efficacy and more causal relationship. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, Chairs, and thank you, Dr. Jaya. Before we formally wrap up the session, I would request Dr. Daryani to kindly felicitate Dr. Oberbaum for his talk.
I'm coming to this.
No, you be here. Don't do this photograph.
Yes,
I'm in the back.
Dr. Daryani?
Not in the back, sir.
No, I'm here. In my presence, you are.
To the. I would request Dr. Mohanty to kindly felicitate Dr. V.K. Gupta.
Thank you.
I now request Dr. Mohanty to felicitate Dr. V.K. Gupta for his talk. I request Dr. Daryani to also felicitate Dr. L.K. Nanda. Now I request Dr. Mohanty to felicitate Dr. Jaya. And I request Dr. Jaya to felicitate both the chairs, Dr. Mohanty and Dr. Daryani. The book that we are giving for felicitation is Iconography of Henneman. It's basically a vivid picture of Henneman's journey through his life. And it has a lot of photographs from Germany and from Paris and from his other places where he has stayed and practiced. Yeah, maybe we can have a session photo, and that would formally conclude the session. Thank you. With this, we come to the end of applied clinical research session. And quickly, without any break, we are going to start with the next session. And for this session on pharmacological or biological evidences, I am going to invite Dr. Rathin Chakravarti, member governing body CCRH, and Dr. Anil Khurana, deputy director general CCRH, Dr. Girish Gupta. They are going to be the chairpersons. Then I'm going to invite Dr. Girish Gupta, who is the founder of Gaurang Clinic and Research Center, and Dr. Devadatta Nayak, scientist to CCRH. They will be the discussants of the session.